morning, friends. In this session, let me explain the concept of gate drains. Now, the next one is epicyclic gate drain. So, what do you mean by epicycloid? Epicycloid is a curve generated from a point on the circle which rotates outside the circumference of another circle, which rotates outside the circumference of another circle. You might have practiced the graphical representation of a epicycloid. When one circle rolls over the another circle, and one circle will have contact with the another circle externally, then the point on this circle generates a curve when it rolls, right? This curve is nothing but epicycloid. This curve is nothing but epicycloid. So here epi means upon which, right? And cyclic means round around or moving around. So if the circle rolls around or upon the another circle, right, then you will get a epicycloid. So here also one of the gear wheel is rotating and rolling. So here we have two types of motions, rotating motion as well as rolling motion, right? So due to this rotation and rolling motion, you will get epicycloid. That's why this train is called gate train is called epicyclic gate train. Let us take two gear wheels A and B. Both are having external contact. Obviously, these are the external type gate drives, and these two are connected by an arm C. Right? A is a gear wheel. B is also gear wheel, and C is an arm, right, which is used to connect two gate drives. Right? Let us take O1 and O2 are the centers of two gear wheels A and B respectively. Right? And gear wheel A is fixed to a frame. Let us take this is a fixed frame. Okay, so it is fixed to this frame, and this gear wheel is free to rotate. This gear wheel is free to rotate. Okay, and the arm is also free to rotate in any direction, either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. Similarly, the gear wheel B is also free to rotate, and similarly, it is free to roll around the circumference of gear wheel B. Okay, so that means here the gear wheel B performs two types of motions, rolling motion as well as rotary motion, rotating about its own axis, similarly rotating about the axis of another gear wheel. So that means the same gear wheel is provided with the two types of rotation, right? Rotation as well as precision. Rotation as well as precision, right? Rotating about its own center is called rotary motion. Rotating about another center, it is called revolutory motion, or it is revolving. So it is gear wheel B is provided with the two types of motion, rotary motion as well as revolving motion. Rotary motion as well as revolving. Rotary means rotating about its own axis. Rotating about its own axis. Revolving motion is nothing but rotating about the axis of somebody or some other body. That is rotating about O1. And here rotary motion is nothing but rotating about O2. O2 is the center of the gear wheel B, and O1 is the center of gear wheel A, right? So when a body is subjected to rotary motion, and simultaneously if it follows revolutory motion about another axis, then the body is said to be in precession motion. Okay, so when the body is in precession motion, then it generates epicyclic curves. It is just like the sun and earth movements, right? The earth rotates about its own center, and it also rotate about the sun. So that's why this also considered as the parallelism or the simple example for sun and planet gear that we will discuss in the epicyclic compound gear trains. Right now, let us say gear A is rotating about center O1. Gears B is rotating about center O2, and at the same time, the gear B is also provided with rotation of gear B about another center O1. Okay. Now, let us consider the gear wheel A is fixed. Timing, let us assume that the gear wheel A is fixed. Okay. And the arm is also fixed. There is no change in the movement of gear wheel A and arm. Obviously, if gear rotates about its own center, O1, right? Let us take the clockwise rotation of gear A. Then obviously, the gear B drives in the anti-clockwise direction, right? Then it becomes a simple gear train. Okay. Suppose if the gear wheel A is free to rotate, Similarly, if the arm is also free to rotate about center O1, then when this gear wheel A rotates, the arm also subjected to the rotation, and this arm carries the gear wheel B around the center of this gear wheel A. So that means it takes the rotation. The gear wheel B takes the rotation in this fashion, then it will become an epicyclic gear train. Okay, is it clear? So that means it rotates about its own center, and at the same time it rotates about another center. That another rotating center movement is called a revolutionary motion. Okay, so the velocity ratio of this epicyclic gear train is explained by two methods. One is a tabular method, another one is a algebraic method. Okay, so let us take the gear wheel A is rotating with a certain speed, and the gear wheel B is also rotating with certain speed, right? Now, if you want to find out the velocity ratio of this, you need to consider two methods, either tabular method or algebraic method. We will see tabular method, which is simpler in solving the problems, right? So now we'll draw a table here. Right, look at the figure here. So this is different types of motions considered for different elements on this epicyclic gear train. So we have how many elements here? We have three elements, right? Gear wheel A, gear wheel B, and then arm C, right? So by giving different motions to these three elements, right, you can get different types of motions. Based on this, we can study the motion of this epicyclic gear drive, and thereby you can calculate the speed ratio or the velocity ratio of this gear drive. Okay, so first, initially, you assume that the arm is fixed. The arm is fixed and it is not free to rotate about its center O1, right? If arm C is fixed, then how many revolutions the arm can complete? Since it is fixed, it can complete only 0 revolutions. It cannot move, right? Since it is fixed. Okay. And A, gear wheel A is free to rotate. Gear wheel A is free to rotate. Let us take only one revolution of gear wheel A. One revolution of gear wheel A. If gear wheel A rotates one revolutions, let us consider the number of revolutions that gear wheel B can complete. This you can calculate based on the velocity ratio, that is equal to NB divided by, how do you calculate the velocity ratio? NB divided by NA is equal to TA divided by TB. Right? Implies, what is number of revolutions that B wheel can complete? TA by TB. TA by TB into NA. TA by TB into NA. So here we are assuming that the gear wheel A is considering only one revolution. Obviously, NA becomes 1. So that you will get TA by TB into 1. Then what is this minus sign and what is the plus sign here? So here I am assuming that the clockwise rotation as positive and anti-clockwise rotation is negative. Anti-clockwise rotation is negative. If you want, you can consider in the opposite sense. If you consider clockwise as a negative, anti-clockwise becomes positive. Okay. So here in this case, I am taking clockwise sense as positive. Anti-clockwise sense of rotation is negative. Since we have external contact between the two gear wheels, obviously both the gear wheels rotates in the opposite direction. Obviously, if one of the gear wheel motion is positive, other gear wheel motion is negative. Okay, so the gear wheel A completes one revolution, gear wheel B completes TA by TB into one revolution. TA by TB into one revolution. Okay, since both are in opposite sense, I am taking minus sign here. If I take minus here, you will get the plus sign. Okay, then that is the first motion we have considered. In the second case, right? Once again, see, arm C is considered as fixed and gear wheel A is free to rotate. But here I am considering X revolutions of gear wheel A. Instead of one revolution, I am considering X revolutions of gear wheel A. So obviously, then what is the revolutions completed by this arm? Because arm is fixed, so obviously number of revolutions 0, right? And A completes how many revolutions? X revolutions, right? Then you find out the number of revolutions that the gear wheel B, which is in mating with the gear wheel A, can complete when the gear wheel A takes X revolution, that is equal to TA by TB into what is NA? How many revolutions? N is nothing but revolutions per minute. How many revolutions we have considered here? X revolutions. Then TA by TB into X. TA by TB into X. Since it is rotating in the opposite sense, I am getting minus sign Q. Okay. Now you consider the third motion. Right? In this, all the three elements are free to rotate. All the three elements are free to rotate. How many revolutions that these three elements are rotating? Let us take Y revolutions. Arm is taking Y revolutions. A is taking Y revolutions. B is also taking Y revolutions. Okay. Then all the three elements, C, A, B, all the three are completing Y revolutions. What is the sense here? All are rotating in the, if this rotates in clockwise direction, the gear wheel rotates in clockwise direction, arm also rotates in clockwise direction, then the gear wheel which is connected to the second end of the arm, it is also subjected to clockwise rotation. That's why you will get plus sign for all the three elements. Now, if you consider total number of revolutions completed by arm in these three motions, you will get plus y revolutions. Total number of revolutions completed by gear wheel A, it is rotating x revolutions about its own center. Along with arm, it is taking another y revolutions, so that the total number of revolutions x plus y, total x plus y revolutions in the same sense. Okay, but when you consider gear wheel B, it is taking y revolutions in the clockwise sense and TA by TB into x revolutions in the anti-clockwise sense. So that's why total number of revolutions equal to algebraic sum of these two, y minus of TA by TB into x. Okay, so if you know the revolutions completed by arm are revolutions completed by gear wheel A, you can find out the revolutions that gear wheel B can complete, right? So if you know the number of revolutions that these three elements can complete, then you can find out the speed ratio of the epicyclic gear drive. Is it clear, all of you?